Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the 2010 NADA Chairman from Portland, Oregon, Ed Tonkin.
Thank you very much. Nice job.
Good afternoon, everybody. It really is great to be back in San Francisco, isn't it? The last time we were here, business was absolutely rolling. But that seems like such a long time ago, doesn't it? In fact, the past couple of years remind me of an album by a very famous San Francisco band, The Grateful Dead. What a long, strange trip it's been. It has been a long, strange trip, but too long and very strange. Who would have thought we'd ride a 3-year roller coaster? Now, our industry was in bad shape and getting worse, but by pulling together, we literally brought ourselves back from the brink of disaster. I gotta tell you, throughout this whole ordeal, one of the most inspirational things for me to hear was from dealers who would call or see me and say, "Ed, I got my dealership back." They were so appreciative of the work that we were doing for them, and I gotta tell you, each dealership matters. There's a saying in my faith, you save one person, you save the world. And I gotta tell you, that's the greatest sense of satisfaction. Now, along the way, we did a few things to help, too. When General Motors and Chrysler were collapsing, we lobbied hard to help them secure bridge loans so they could even stay in business. And then when their bankruptcies resulted in terrible and tragic dealer cuts, we got Congress to pass dealer rights legislation. And then when auto sales dropped in half in 2009, almost overnight, well, we knew something had to be done. So we worked with the Department of Transportation and Congress, and we developed the Cash for Clunkers program. But most recently, when the administration tried to include dealer-assisted financing in its major Wall Street reform bill, which could have in effect killed our F&I departments, well, this time we really pulled together to win against tremendous odds. Nobody, and I mean nobody, thought we'd be able to overcome the powerful forces against us. Simply put, the deck was absolutely stacked against us. Now just think about it for a minute. A myriad of consumer groups, the Treasury Department, the military, the Pentagon, even the President himself, he wanted us covered by that bill. You all know the outcome. We succeeded. And to this, we succeeded. And to this very day, I'm still on the TSA no-fly list. It's a good thing my brother has a plane. We won against tremendous odds. And I gotta tell you, this was not easy. In fact, it was kind of like watching a zombie movie. Every time we thought we'd won, our opponents they rose from the dead to come back at us again and again and again. And every time they did, we rose to the occasion. I mean, this was a grassroots effort the likes of which Washington has never seen. We know that because they told us as much. Now, we couldn't and didn't win without having your actions, without your involvement, and without your persistence. In short, we prevailed because we were united. Oh yeah, we survived brutal times all right, but things are getting better. You can feel it. It's long overdue, and boy, does it feel good. In fact, a few weeks ago, I visited the Detroit Auto Show, and I can tell you there's a renewed sense of optimism out there. The mood was great, and it tells me we're really on the way back. And who would have thought we would end 2010 with almost 12 million in sales? And who would have thought that economists would be predicting 13 million sales for this year and 15 million sales by 2015? So now it's time for us to step on the gas and look to the future. Our challenge now is to do everything in our power to keep things moving forward. And the good news is, this industry's recovery is real because it's based on vehicles that are fueling the consumer's imagination. So let's not throw a roadblock in front of this recovery. Right now, the EPA and the Department of Transportation are circulating a proposal to dramatically increase fuel economy standards. Now let's take a look at the number they're talking about. 62. That's 62 miles per gallon for a fleet by 2025. So you think, who could possibly be against that? Who could be against that? But 62 miles per gallon raises a lot of questions. Can it even be done? I mean, is it technologically feasible? And if so, at what cost? Are we going to price consumers out of the market? Or is this just another attempt by our government to force a change in consumer behavior? Now remember, who is the most important person in the auto industry? You all know the answer. It's not Ackerson, it's not Mullally or Marchione. It's not even the president. It's the consumer. Nothing happens without a buyer. And some of these environmental improvements come at a real cost. Now you don't have to look very far for examples. Take Sun Chips. Sun Chips. You all know what Sun Chips are? The snack food. These guys. Well, that's right. About a year ago, Frito-Lay started packaging these Sun Chips in a bag that was 100% biodegradable. You couldn't find a bag that was more friendly to the environment. I mean, this just had to be a huge success. It was a no-brainer, right? But there was one big problem. People stopped buying Sun Chips. They hated the new biodegradable bag. You know why? It's too loud.
Launched this bag 18 months ago, all excited about it. It was 100% compostable. The only problem?
All right, if anyone's hungry, they're right there. It turned out you can't open this bag without disturbing everybody around you. Former Sun Chips worshippers, they compared the noise of that bag from everything from a lawnmower to a jet engine. In fact, if you can believe this is hard to believe, 44,000 consumers joined a Facebook group called, "Sorry, but I can't hear you over the Sun Chips bag." True. So who do you think, pardon the pun, who do you think was left holding the bag? Well, Frito-Lay, of course. And now Frito-Lay says they're going back to the old bag. But the mistake cost the company millions. So what's the lesson here? It's this. Make sure you know what the consumer really wants before you make big changes to your product. Now, if you realize just how much a $1.99 bag of snack food changed consumer behavior, just imagine what can happen to our industry when you talk about cars and trucks costing $30,000 to $50,000. I first raised these questions in a speech I made to the automotive press in Detroit in October. And since that time, a number of studies have come out that found that those fuel economy standards would absolutely decrease sales, and they could even eliminate about 1.5 million jobs nationwide. And that's something we absolutely don't need. Hybrid technology, on average, today, adds about $5,300 to the price of a new vehicle. And at today's fuel prices, even our government puts the payback for the consumers between 4 to 5 years. So just imagine what 62 miles per gallon could cost. And 2 weeks ago, an IBM-backed study reported that 71% of consumers said that the primary motivating factor for them to switch to an electric vehicle was lower price. Now, Raising serious questions about fuel economy does not mean we're against improving fuel economy. It's quite the contrary. We've long supported improving fuel economy. But we also know that it must be based on sound public policy and not just wishful thinking. And this is just one of the issues on the radar screen. So whether it's the government, the economy, or the government, did I say government? We have to remain vigilant. And my successor, Stephen Wade, is going to discuss what to expect over the next 12 months when he speaks to you on Monday, the day I hand the gavel over. Look, looking back, with everything that's happened the last couple of years, we all asked ourselves, is there light at the end of the tunnel? Well, we knew there was. We just didn't know how long the tunnel would be. And with all that's been going on the last couple of years, a lot of people came up to me and said, Ed, why do you do this job? You might think that my timing wasn't very good, but it was. I can tell you without a doubt, the very best part of this job was traveling around this country, meeting dealers. Meeting dealers that were engaged, big and small, urban and rural, even internationally. And finally, one day, it dawned on me. I know what that light at the end of the tunnel is. And it isn't a bigger market. And it isn't newer models. And it isn't even a recovering economy. That light at the end of the tunnel is you. It's the dealers of this country. It's the thousands of dealers and their employees working through thick and thin to do what we do best, which is taking care of our customers. And still reveling in the excitement of every buyer as we all hear the three most magical words in our business, I'll take it. Because I got to tell you, we're not selling cars and we're not selling trucks. We're selling dreams. We're selling livelihoods. We're selling mobility and lifestyle. We provide for our customers so they can work, play, and live. We are that light. You know, I learned an awful lot about this business from my dad, Ron Tonkin, from watching him be a great dealer. He was good to his customers, good to his employees, and good to his community. And as an NADA board member, and in 1989 as NADA president, he was great for our industry. And his credo is simple. No matter how you come into this business, leave it better for the next generation. That's why I did this job. To do my part to better this business that's been so good for so many of us for the next generation. To try to leave it just a little bit better off than it was before me. And frankly, that's the continuing challenge of everyone in this industry. All of us, dealers, employees, automakers, NADA, we all must work even harder to assure that our industry remains a model for the rest of the world. For me personally, I can tell you that this has been an extraordinary year for me in so many ways. And I am very humbled by the opportunity you afforded me, and believe me, it will remain a part of my life forever. And for that, I can't thank you enough. And so when I think about that album title I referred to, what I think is this. What a long, exhilarating, challenging, rewarding, and inspirational trip it's been. It's going to be a great year. Thank you all very much.